All right, I'm gonna get started back up. I know some people will be flowing back in from lunch. I know there were long lines. So appreciate those who were able to get back in time. And for those still over in the other room, feel free to stay there and listen in on the live feed over there. I did want to take 1 second of editorial rights for being the MC of this and just comment that before the break, it was fantastic to look out at the crowd. And I'd say we have probably 50-50 on male-female split. And I would be willing to bet for most of you that's not what you see in your normal office. So I want to say that to me, that just emphasizes the fact that for all of you women who came out to this and said, this is what I'm interested in, this is why, you're the future, right? We're looking to change the way things are done. So thank you for taking the time to come out and do that and know that there are folks who support you and we're excited that you're here. And I will say, it's well more than 50% females who made it back on time. So thank you for that as well. And with that one editorial piece, I will kick it over on our next panel on modular procurement and moderated by Mark Jones.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming back from lunch. Hopefully this will be an exciting panel. So my name's Mark Jones. I'm on the board of AGL. I'm also with Civic Actions as an attorney. And I have Dan Levinson, who's a former contracting officer with CMS. He's currently the chief strategy officer for Agile 6. And Dave Zvinich, former executive director of 18F and independent attorney right now. So we're going to talk, I think the title section is actually modular contracting, but I think both of you are going to be comfortable talking about modular procurement in general, since the process is a little bit more exciting than just the contracting part. So Dan, maybe you can start off and just explain to us what modular contracting is and what modular procurement is.
Sure. Modular procurement, modular contracting, I don't know to differentiate too much now, but it's really taking an approach where rather than going out with, a one size fits all massive procurement, hundreds of millions of dollars or even larger, trying to say, hey, we want end to end services for this IT system or this thing that we're going to build. It's looking at it and saying, how can we chunk this work up? How can we divide this work into smaller, more ingestible pieces that one, allow kind of align with digital service practices, saying, hey, maybe focusing with discovery and research first before we actually decide to build anything, helping to understand the problem space before. But also, when you break work into smaller pieces, it opens it up to a much larger vendor pool. And non-traditional vendors and others, have a chance to kind of to play in that space and actually bring their unique talents and skills where, there may be, and a lot of people who spoke today have firms that are, awesome HCD or design firms, they may not do, DevOps or, full stack development. So by taking a modular approach, you're really able to go to just broaden the pool of vendors who are able to go to the work and also really, understand the problem space a little bit more and just take that more incremental approach that kind of aligns with, Agile and digital services.
So does that mean that when you're doing modular contracting, you're really looking for like a single service from a single vendor and bringing multiple vendors in on a larger project if you're trying to do that? Does it mean just doing smaller projects? Or how do the different modules interact together?
Sure. I mean, I think the first answer I'd give is, it can mean a lot of different things. And I think, first and foremost, there's never a one-size-fits-all approach. And just like, I know Eduardo was up here recently talking about the importance of design and understanding the problem space. I think that goes into how you break your procurements up. Sometimes a larger procurement may be more appropriate. Sometimes breaking them up into, much smaller pieces, really focusing again on the discovery or research or design phase up front. I just think it's really important to understand the ecosystem that you're working in. And by that I mean, what is the culture of the office that you may be working with? What is the access to users? What is the infrastructure, kind of the governance process there? So all of that is really going to influence what, the optimal approach may be for a specific, kind of procurement or thing that you're buying.
And going off of that, Dave, could you talk a little bit about like modular contracting procurement's relationship to agile project management and digital services in general, how they fit together?
Sure.
Is it the same thing? Are they required to work together?
Well, they're related. So before I go too far, can I get a sense of like the room? How many of you are government employees? Okay. How many of you are vendors? Okay. How many of vendors used to be government employees? All right. And last question, How many of you are like technologists, like you've written code or you write and work in software teams? All right, so good mix. The main thing that I think a lot about when I think about modular procurement as it relates to digital services is that fundamentally we're talking about teams. And this is actually the weird part about most digital services work is that you're actually just, you have teams. You have a lot of different teams, sometimes smaller teams, sometimes larger teams, sometimes collections of teams. But fundamentally, all digital services are built using teams. And so one thing that we sometimes think about is like as we're acquiring vendors from the government perspective, it's like, okay, well, you could hire one vendor to deliver all of your teams. Or you could have a couple of vendors delivering smaller numbers of teams. And fundamentally, the question then shifts a little bit to, all right, well, what are the elements that we want to have as a good procurement ecosystem? Do we want good competition? Well, if we want good competition, that means typically we want to have multiple vendors who are all competitive. You also want to make sure that in the period of performance that you have strong, you know, that you have sort of internal incentives for teams to deliver. And so one of the things that's interesting about modular contracting is that modular contracting takes some of these ideas of like, okay, we want to have teams, we want to have teams have the right incentives, we want there to be some trade-offs, like we want teams to sometimes not be as optimally perfect as you might expect in like the ideal situation, but you're hedging your bets a little bit to say, we're going to make some trade-offs, maybe we have a little bit of inefficiency because you're working with multiple vendors, but the benefit is now that you have, you're less bought, like you're less totally like, you know, in the same sinking ship with one vendor, and instead you're spreading out your bets across different vendors. So from a modular contracting perspective, what that does is that lets you say, well, let's hire the best vendor for the job, which fundamentally is like, that's a really basic proposition. Let's hire the best vendor for the job. It's just defining the requirements a little bit more narrowly than you might otherwise define it. Instead of saying, well, I want the classic example that we worked on with California was like, I want a child welfare system. Well, great, that's actually many pieces. It's not just a child welfare system. There's hosting and infrastructure. There's the data layer. There's the user interface. There are different types of users with different user interface needs. And so you're not going to build all of that at once. You're actually going to have multiple teams working over time. So how do we sequence our contracts? How do we structure our contracts in a way that promotes competition? How do we structure our contracts in a way that promotes delivery? And then build in incentives on the vendor side, and also build in accountability on the government side to make sure that they're actually, you know, not just saying, all right, well, I'm going to give all the work to everybody and hope that it all works out. Instead, building in some sense of accountability throughout.
And when you're talking about the teams, are we just talking about teams that the government is acquiring, just the vendor teams?
No.
Or is there a team on the government side as well?
Yeah, so it's actually on both sides. There has to be... I think about teams both on the acquisition team. So I spend most of my time thinking about federal procurement. The federal acquisition regulation, for all of its faults, actually notes that there's this concept of an acquisition team, a government acquisition team. And the government acquisition team is not just the CO, the contracting officer, or the contracting specialist. It's actually the contracting officer, the program, it's the IT in the context of technology, it's the lawyers. Interestingly enough, it's also the contractor. The contractor's part of the acquisition team. And what's unfortunate about most government contracting is that the team that exists on the government side is not really durable for the life of the procurement. Like you'll sometimes start with a contract, you'll have the program and they'll throw the contract over the wall to the contracting officer, and then they'll throw that over to the contracting specialist, and then they'll throw that over to legal, and then they'll throw it over to industry, who they've never talked to before, that they actually get it back, and then industry will respond back, and then they'll go to the technical evaluation panel, who was pulled in the last minute, doesn't know anything about the requirements, doesn't really know anything about, you know, what they're trying to achieve. Then they'll hire the contractor, a new team, because this was 8 months ago. The new team comes in and they don't really know what's going on, and you can see all of this sort of sequencing means that you don't actually have that durability of, from I've got a problem, who's going to help me solve it? And so having the government acquisition team sort of in a more durable, with a more durable commitment to each other allows them to have some better conversations internally. And then on the post-award side, you're actually going to have delivery teams, so the folks who are actually going to be working together, your designers, your engineers, your product managers, your content strategists and the like, working with your product owners and the government team to actually deliver something of value. So you do have, you're right to call that out, that there's the government acquisition team sort of pre-award, and then there's the ultimate delivery team post-award.
And Dan, how does all of this relate to, how is it different than traditional contracting? I mean, it sounds like there's still a lot of the same steps, right? You still need to do a procurement process. You still need to have evaluation committees. You still need a delivery team. How is this different than traditional contracting?
Yeah, so I think, you know, kind of following on what Dave said there, the importance of teams, and, you know, from my experience, I worked with the U.S. Digital Service team at CMS, basically kind of designing the procurement and then building out the quality payment program there, a piece of legislation kind of moving to more managed outcome-based care. And one of the first things we did was really the importance of teams and working as integrated, you know, integrated project teams. You know, and when you look at a lot of traditional procurements, there's an antagonistic relationship between the program office or the procurement office and the vendors, and then often the procurement office and the program offices as well.
Can I just interject there? This is so fascinating. When you have like a contract, if you talk to a contracting officer, like what's wrong with procurement? They're like, the program doesn't know the requirements. And you talk to a contracting officer, or you talk to the program, like what's wrong with the contracting officer? Like, oh, they don't understand our program. And then you have IT, and then IT says, well, you know, they don't even understand technology. Why are you even talking about technology? You shouldn't know about technology. That's my job. And then you have the lawyers who go, what, I don't know what any of this is about. Like, just, you know, just give me the package when it's complete. And then finance is going, do you even have the budget for any of this? And like, you have all of these folks who like don't actually work with each other and just like basically go like, all right, let me know when you're ready, you know?
Right, no, exactly. And that's, you know, my experience. We were at different areas of the federal government, but I think it's a similar experience where you go. So, you know, one of the first things I tried to do was let's align around what is some shared success or shared definition of success. And you know, when you look at the procurement office, most people, for them, success is, are we spending all the money and are we not getting a protest? When you can't prevent a protest, because for a lot of vendors, their business model is throw it against the wall, is it going to stick?
Yep.
You know, there's not that much legal cost to potentially kind of, you know, throw a wrench in an award and potentially turn that award.
Yep.
So I would say, well, what about our responsibility to taxpayers? What about users? And what about the actual people using what we're building?
Dan, come on, that's crazy.
Right. So I think modular procurement, because you're breaking things into smaller pieces, you know, working as teams, but also it kind of gets at that whole, you know, I think stress throughout the day was the fear of failure. And when you're breaking into smaller pieces and you may have, you know, for the procurement I worked on, we did, you know, took a modular approach, and I would say the average procurements were maximum of $20 million versus the $500 million contract that it replaced.
Right.
So because we're taking these smaller, you know, bite-sized contracts, there's a little bit more appetite to try things differently, to find room for innovation, to take an outcome-based approach. So I think, you know, that is really like, you know, some of the benefits and, you know, how it just really aligns with, you know, the whole approach to digital services and just like the themes throughout the day of fear of failure, team-based approach.
And if I could just like sort of pick up on that, I think there are sort of two related threads. So one, we heard about Conway's law earlier today, which is that you have like the, you know, the system resembles the communications patterns of the team. Well, the reality is if you have 10 teams that are working on something, it's always going to be challenging. There's always going to be failure. There's always going to be some degree of like, this is messy and confusing. And so one of the advantages of modular contracting is that it surfaces those challenges and those pain points earlier. So rather than having a $500 million contract that sits at the very end and you're like, oh, wait, now it doesn't work? That stinks. It's better to know at 6 months in to be like, wow, people are really having a hard time communicating with each other. We should probably do something about that. And when you have those conversations, those are actually much more productive early conversations. So like Conway's law will exist. It's inevitable law of nature. But if you're using it to your advantage, then suddenly modular contracting sort of helps you realize where your pain points really exist earlier. And then the other thing is, like, you are going to fail. Okay. It's, you know, like, I remember someone, there was this one meeting that we had where we were talking about, like, a $500 million contract. And, like, well, that, they're like, it's going to fail. And I was like, cool, well, let's try this modular contracting thing. That's going to fail, too. I was like, great. All right, so let's try something. You know, if we're going to fail faster, sooner, I guess we'll learn faster and sooner, and then we can try the next thing.
Yeah, and I think, you know, failing faster and with, you know, taking a, you know, modular approach to procurement and using just agile methodologies, you know, part of agile is that it exposes pain points earlier, like
yep.
you had mentioned. And I think, you know, one thing I stressed is the importance of keeping perspective. You know, traditional government contracts, hey, it's a 5-10 year, multi-$100 million contract, a vendor's going off kind of in a black box somewhere working. Just because you can't hear your users crying you're not showing them anything doesn't mean they're not crying.
Right.
So I think it's important to keep that perspective, because I have seen some agile, smaller modular contracts, and hey, we're exposing problems early.
Yep.
Oh man, look at this problem. Like, can you believe this?
Yep.
And just keeping that perspective that there are tons of problems, but the vendor's just going off and hiding everything from you until they deliver a broken system that doesn't work, and yep. you're too embarrassed to say anything about it and just spend $200 million all over again.
So is with modular procurement, modular contracting, is it just doing, you know, instead of one $500 million contract, it's 10 $50 million contracts all for 5 years? Or how does the process help reveal those problems sooner? What are some other differences, just besides the sheer dollar amount?
Yeah, and I think the kind of, as I had mentioned earlier, understanding the ecosystem and just the nuance that goes into how you kind of chunk those contracts up. So, you know, you may do some, using the micro purchase threshold maybe, you're just doing discovery, you're getting someone in there for a day or two. You know, where we say, hey, we want to do some actual real in-depth research and we want to go for 6 months and have research. And when we decide to hire development teams, we want to, you know, spread the risk out, hire a few teams, but we're going to actually feed them personas and journey maps. And they're going to go in and they're going to understand the problem space so much more. Again, that doesn't, you know, assure success, but it reduces, you know, greatly reduces the probability of building the wrong thing, which, you know, the government does too often.
Right. I mean, I think to answer the question, Mark, it's focusing on, I often focus on teams and trade-offs and sort of how they relate to each other. And so to answer the question of whether it should be a 5 year or it should be a 1 year or it should be some, you know, what the period of performance is going to be, it's going to be dependent on your knowledge of the problem space. If you have a lot of knowledge of the problem space, it's a really, really, really well-defined problem, 5 years is probably fine. If the problem is not really well-defined, if you don't really understand all of the nuances, you probably don't want to spend for 5 years, because predicting 5 years out in the future is quite difficult. And so as you start to understand your own knowledge, your own uncertainty, your own risk, modular contracting gives you the flexibility to re-examine your own assumptions and then back into what makes the most sense for your particular product. I mean, I sometimes think about this reality that all technology eventually becomes obsolete. And it's just a question of like, all right, if we're going to be contracting for a long period of time, why don't we just contract for like 50 years, right? Well, because that would be ridiculous. Who could plan what's going to be, well, it's going to happen in 20, you know, in 2059 or 2069. Why would we contract for that long? It's like, well, cool. That's basically how long, you know, it's like as crazy as trying to contract for 5 years around technology. And so as we start to understand our own, like what our limitations are and what our needs are, you need to structure your contract in the way that makes sense for your product.
So when you have all these different teams and you've got different contract lengths, you have to do some evaluation. How do you know if your contractors are actually delivering work for you in this process? Are you still just waiting to, so maybe you do a one-day contract, maybe you do a six-month contract. Are you waiting to that end of the 6 months and going, okay, thanks, here's the work product, and then you find another vendor? Or what's the relationship during the course of the contract?
So, you know, I think in a lot of these topics, it's modular procurement kind of aligning with, you know, agile or human-centered acquisition as well, where, you know, there needs to be a certain level of transparency. Mm-hmm. You know, there needs to be people, you know, following the agile manifesto, people over process, you know, collaboration over contract negotiation. You know, you should be willing to demo and, you know, demo working software, working code, or even just demo whatever work. Maybe it isn't working code, whatever, you know, personas, drawings, what, you know, sketches on a napkin, whatever it may be. But there needs to be a level of transparency, whether it's, you know, every week, every 2 weeks, every 3 weeks, whatever that cadence may be. But you need to, you know, have that level of transparency to assure that while we may be, you know, building something, building sketches, that, hey, we're going to throw these things out, but hopefully you're learning something from that. So I think, you know, that level of transparency, to me, you really can't decouple that from modular contracting. And that, you know, that is what, you know, whether or not you're building the right thing, you're going to know more quickly. And that's part of, you know, the focus on, you can have these smaller contracts because it gives you the ability to pivot quicker when you have that kind of exposure and that level of transparency.
So I would add to that, you know, I used to say that, you know, with Agile, the ultimate metric of success is working software. But I think that's actually misses something important, which is in government, it's not, and true actually outside of government as well, it's not just whether you have working software, it's whether you have working software that's used, right? Whether people are actually using the software and getting the stuff delivered. And so I often think about when you're talking about digital service delivery, for example, The Brits have this really excellent, like these four indicators that they use. They talk about the cost per transaction, they talk about the digital take up, but they also talk about customer satisfaction. What a novel concept, like should our government services have high satisfaction rates? And then also, you know, completion rates. What a novel concept. If you sign up for something, you should actually be able to like complete, get the service completed. But the thing that's interesting is that those things are all in tension. You could spend bajillions of dollars, and sometimes government does, on trying to get something that delights people, but that's a bajillion dollars on something that delights people. If you're trying to spend less money, well, okay, what trade-offs are you willing to make? Maybe you're willing to accept a slightly lower completion rate, or maybe you're willing to accept a slightly lower, lower satisfaction. The mark of a good team is gonna be the team that helps you understand those trade-offs well. Right? So those are the folks who are going to be experts and say, you can't have everything. You can't do it all. You're going to have to make trade-offs in different ways. Either it's not going to be as performant, or maybe it's not going to be as available, or maybe you're going to actually lose data. Like, there are things that, you know, you're going to have to make trade-offs, and understanding what those trade-offs are and being able to reason about them and make choices is actually what a good delivery team will help you understand. Oh, we could do this. Sure, it's going to cost you more money, which is usually what vendors say. So that's like not a great approach. And instead say, well, if we do this, this means that this population is going to be less well served. Or if we do this, it's going to mean that we can't get this feature completed in this amount of time. Or if we do this, it's actually not going to be consistent with some of our other design choices that we've made. So what do you want to do? And a good delivery team is going to help you understand what those trade-offs are. And so as I think about, you know, what is the ultimate metric in modular contracting, is the software being used, A, and then B, do you trust your team to help you make those choices? If you don't trust the delivery team to help you make those choices based on their experience, based on what they've actually delivered, you've got the wrong team. Get rid of them and put someone in that's right.
And who's responsible for monitoring those metrics in your mind? Is that the program office? Is it the technology department overseeing the vendor?
That's a categorical mistake. It's the government, and it's the team that involves the contracting officer, the program, IT. They have to work together as a team. You can't just have like one office handling it.
So does this mean that there are your job as a contracting officer, if you're in procurement, looks differently underneath this if you're doing it correctly?
Yes.
Yeah. And to add on to that a little bit, I think, you know, viewing the job, and if you look at the FAR, you know, it clearly states the job of a contracting officer is a business advisor. And part of that is ruthless prioritization, as far as there are going to be trade-offs. We live in the real world. You know, unless you want to say there's unlimited time and unlimited money, which is never the case, something is going to have to give at some point. Whereas, you know, traditional kind of the role as contracting officer was viewed as, you know, hey, you have to abide by this regulation. If anything goes wrong, it's the end of the world. We're not willing to accept anything less than every line of the SOW, shall do this, shall do that. So I think really viewing the role has to transition to more being that business advisor and then being someone who can be that, you know, partner on the other side as part of that team and say, this is what we're prioritizing. And, you know, obviously based on talking to users, understanding users, and, you know, even just participatory design. So while it's not even always just the end user, stakeholders at the agency, legal, whoever it may be, and involving them, you know, in those trade-off decisions.
And how often are procurement officers underneath this system engaging with that contractor? Are they waiting until problems arise? Is it like once a month?
So it's interesting. We were talking about a mutual colleague, Ryan Cooey, who's at CMS and is a contracting officer. And I was asking him about the administration of a contract that Dan wrote a contract, left government, and then Ryan was picking it up and carrying it forward. And I asked Ryan, I was like, you know, how has your life been as a contracting officer on this? And the thing that he said was really astonishing and has always stuck. He's like, I don't have to do mods anymore.
Yep.
Like, this is the life of a contracting officer, is basically processing modifications to the existing contract. And he doesn't have to do mods because they adopted this structure where you don't do mods anymore. You focus your energy on getting the right task orders cut at the right time. So you're not screwing around 6 months later trying to mod it to meet whatever the new requirement is. And so the administration is actually different. You're still going to have hands-on administration. It's not like you're going to walk away from that. So anyone who tells you, oh, there's going to be less work, they're wrong, they're lying, it's more work. But it's different work. It's actually more meaningful work. It's work where you're actually working to understand what trade-offs you're willing to make as a government, and then making the right decisions as a government about what's going to serve the public better.
Yeah, no, you know, I think into that is you know, and making decisions to go towards, you know, using a certain type of contracting or approach, you know, what are we prioritizing? And one thing I always prioritize was we have to be, you know, let's be realistic about the overhead within a procurement office as far as when we are doing all of these modifications.
Yep.
If it is, you know, a cost plus contract and we're doing these award fees, not to say that's never the right answer to have an award fee, but a lot of overhead, and you know, that could be for two or three people a quarter of their year or half of their year just writing these award fee reports. So
this is a good use of everyone's time, incidentally, having just a bunch of people sitting around writing reports that basically guarantees that the award fee comes out to 100% anyway. Like that, this is not how we should be structuring it. But we say, oh, we need cost plus.
Right.
Why? Well, just because that's how we've done it before.
Because we feel like we have more control and can micromanage the vendor. And you know, when in reality, you know, I was a big proponent, and you know, working with Ryan and others, let's move as much as we can to the market research phase. Let's make sure we can understand before we have to get into the tighter box of kind of procurement regulation.
Right.
Let's understand the market. Let's understand where we're buying. Let's understand the vendors there. And then once we get them in, let's give a little bit of trust because we have that team-based approach. And things may fail sometimes.
Yep.
But you know, if you understand, you know, understanding the system, there are other mechanisms as far as, okay, well, there's a CPARS report, or you know, people talk as far as market research. And you know, hey, if the vendor, you give them some goodwill and they kind of, you know, burn you and don't have kind of good intent there, there are different avenues instead of just burning five people's year on overhead, you know, writing, again, kind of meaningless reports.
Right. And I mean, I think the flip is that there's so, like, government goes through this incredible, like, energy to avoid certain things. Like, so my favorite thing is, like, we talk about competition. We like competition, right? But then a program always says, well, I know what I want. Well, what does that mean? That means that they're not going to be open to competition. Okay, so what they do is then they come up with like these weird sort of workarounds so they can avoid competition. Well, then a couple of things happen. One, they get the same vendors that they've had before, and they're like, well, that's not what I wanted. Well, okay, but you can't just like hope that it's gonna you're gonna apply the same approach and get a different result, or you're gonna get protested, or what's gonna eventually happen is that the thing that you bought today, 6 months from now, they're going to swap in their B team or their C team, and you're going to be like, oh, well, this is no good.
Right.
I want the A team back. And you're like, well, I'm sorry, you've got 5 years. You can certainly do this in option year four. Everyone's unhappy. So instead of doing that, if we just like were more honest and said, well, we're willing to accept competition because we're focused on market research, because we're doing those types of things early, we're talking to industry and willing to accept that some industry says that they're good and they're not, and some industry is actually legitimately good, and some industry is okay but can be great. When you have those conversations, suddenly acquisition moves away from being a game to actually getting the right people to do the project. And that's sort of the fundamental thing, is that if we start from the proposition that government should be trying to acquire the best teams to deliver the right product, everything else sort of flows from that. So we don't have to spend all of our time trying to fit everything into like, well, this is how we've done this in the past. The team starts with, all right, who's the best, what's the best structure for delivery? And then let everything else flow.
So does that mean that in that market research phase, you've got to figure out that best structure for the entire life of that project?
Absolutely.
And make sure you have the best team in place at first? Or are there things that you can do, you know, 3 months in when you realize you're like, okay, this wasn't a long contract, but I was kind of hoping to stick you around, and you realize like, oh, they don't even have an A team.
So yeah, this is a, so I think about this in two dimensions. So I was actually, I gave a presentation the other day where we were talking about the game of Risk. You know the game Risk? Does everyone know the game Risk? So there was this Monte Carlo simulation that an MIT student did about the optimal strategy for playing the game Risk. Does anyone know what it is? Yeah, it's Australia. You take the small continents first. That is actually how you win the game of Risk. Is that when, and this is not just me. This is like math and like, you know, like that's how that goes. And so the way that you win the game of Risk is you take small continents first. Well, if all you did was take Australia, that's a really, really crappy way to win Risk, right? So you have to go by starting to take Australia, start to take, you know, take the small continents, and then you have to plan for how am I going to take North America, how am I going to take Europe, how am I going to take Asia, right? And so as we think about modular contracting, you have to start with, well, what do I know now? Well, I'm going to take a small continent first, but you want to plan for taking the rest of the, you know, take world domination. And so you have to, at the same time, if you're thinking small and what do you get those quick wins, how are you actually going to carry this thing all the way to whatever the top scale is? And you have to think in both dimensions at the same time.
And I just to add on to that, I mean, I think, you know, at a very basic level, it's, you know, introducing those feedback loops where, hey,
yes,
you're taking Australia, and then what are we learning from that? And, you know, at its heart, that's agile, you know, listening and responding to change. And I think, you know, that's why modular procurement is, you know, is it makes so much sense and aligns with just an agile iterative approach, because you do have those tighter feedback loops versus 5-10 year contract in a black box. And even on those, because there's no transparency, there's no learning there.
Right.
So at some point, then you're just basically, you know, throwing something out and kind of starting from scratch all over again. And that explains a lot of the lack of innovation in the procurement space over the last however many years.
Right.
Thanks. I think we're out of time. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. I do just want to say, though, I think you should go with South America, because you've got more options on what to do next.
Look, the numbers don't lie.